right, welcome back to episode 7. Oh wait, Rob's taking a call.
Oh, sorry. On. Yeah. My MPX, I'm always getting calls. I don't know if I should take it like this or like this.
Yeah, who knows?
You know. Who knows?
Now, gosh. Technically, now as you know, this is episode 7, the great app gap. And so we're in Windows Phone land. So technically your phone is
it's out of date,
not quite part of the canon, as they say.
It's out of date. It's not part of the canon. You're right. I know. Shame on me.
You mentioned to me that you got a surprise gift box here.
I did get a gift box from our good friend Bob Rapp. And we met at an undisclosed underground parking garage where he passed along, I don't know, maybe 30 different Windows phones, Windows mobile devices. I think there's a Ken in here as well, actually.
Ooh,
so, and a Zune. It's exciting, you know? Gosh.
What is that?
Well, it looks like a... Is that a Jornada?
Is that an Ethernet compact flash card or something?
In fact, it is. Actually, that's like for a phone line. That's not even Ethernet. Whoa. It's too small.
PSTN or something?
Wow. So you could be Yeah. Pretty exciting.
Like a war games thing. You're just missing your floppy drive, and you could tunnel that into the DoD. You know, whopper.
Which we do a lot, you know, just for fun. Sure. You know, absolutely. So what is this episode all about, Pete?
This episode, it's we had Joe B on the last episode. Hopefully people saw that because that was
pretty exciting. Yeah.
And yeah, that was the launch of Windows Phone, birth of Windows Phone.
Right.
And now we are taking a step back and we're going to talk to some esteemed guests in the developer community that were there. They were in the room when it happened and really trying to get apps developed for Windows Phone, which it ranks just below like bomb detonator for pleasant jobs.
Yeah, it turns out after a thing,
food taster for the king or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. So though we had all these great commercials and advertisements of why you didn't need to spend so much time in your apps, you know, get in, get out, get on with your life. It turns out people really wanted to hang out in apps.
Yeah. Yep. So we're gonna go through all that today, and we've got some gear to look at, and we've got the guests to talk to. I thought maybe we'd start with a little bit of a baseline for those that are not super familiar with exactly the essence of Windows Phone. Joe B talked about it last time. Maybe I'll play this video, and it's gonna run through a bunch of the UI and kind of experience. You want to do that first?
Absolutely. And people today will realize what they're missing when they see that
there you go.
Beautiful UI.
Yeah, if you saw a phone like this today, you'd be like, So let's see what it looks like here.
All right.
The audio is a little distorted, I'd say. It's just weird early 2000s.
Threads. I wonder if that'll ever be a thing.
So what's cool is they would interspersed text and Facebook messages like in one thread.
Amazing.
It was kind of like multimodal messaging.
Right.
Pretty cool.
It's like having a unified inbox.
unified inbox, unified threads. Bring it all together. Little thing action. Internet Explorer.
I love it. It looks good. That looks like HTML.
We're
going to
talk a little bit about that today. Yeah. The challenge of
live like a local.
This is pretty cool here. This local stuff is really cool.
That's super cool.
That was pretty cool. Expect the unexpected.
Wow.
It's coming fall 2011.
Wow, that's so long ago.
Yeah, so that was the Mango, I believe, Mango release they were advertising.
I liked Mango.
Yeah, Mango had a lot of good stuff. Kind of filled in a lot of gaps from the launch.
It did. Do you remember kind of a whole lot of people wanting to just say, let's just call it Mango? Like, not just the code name, but people, there was like a swelling of people who said, that's just a cool name. Let's just call it Windows Phone Mango, like publicly everywhere. Didn't happen.
Yeah. Well, we went from Windows Phone 7 series to Windows Phone 7 to Windows Phone, I think 7.5.
That's right. And you know what? The days of expecting the unexpected are gone. People don't expect the unexpected anymore. They are getting an incremental upgrade every year. And so it's all expected. Right. Yeah. No surprises.
Expect.
Lower the bar and you won't be disappointed.
There you go. That's a good phrase.
That's impassioned.
Mm. Yeesh. But yeah. Well, you know, what we saw when we started this journey back in we started with Windows CE and stuff. And remember all the weird, you talked about the MPX, all these weird form factors and weird experimentation with Palm and Symbian and Windows Mobile. And everyone was doing crazy stuff. And yeah. It's sort of like it's become very normalized.
It has.
A couple of so ecosystems, more, same thing.
More boring. Factor. Normal, boring, not exciting, you know. What a tragedy. You know, it's amazing to me, and we brought it up a few times, especially when we head over to London at the museum, is how small the phones were back then. And even when a seemingly giant phone came out back then in the Windows Mobile days, it just is dwarfed by today's smartphones.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Because just looking at them, they're just like, oh, it reminds me of a Zoolander, you know, almost. When he had the little tiny, exactly. Yeah, that's what it feels like. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know. Well, there you have it.
Well, why don't we? Speaking of gear, why don't we head over the pond here?
I think it sounds like a good idea.
To look at. All right. Here we
Perfect.
Go.
All right. Well, we're gonna do our off to the museum segment here, and we are back in the UK with Ben and Matt at the Mobile Phone Museum. And this is the part of the show where we kind of dig into the gear. Everyone loves the gear. Everyone has a drawer full of phones. Probably everyone watching this has a drawer full of phones, I would say.
Probably. It's definitely my favorite museum by far.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
Absolutely.
There's no question about it. I mean, there's the Natural History Museum. There's the Museum of Modern Art. I mean, these are all
boring.
Small taters compared to this boring stuff. Yeah, cool. So Ben and Matt, welcome back.
Thank you very much. Great to be back. And the story continues. So I think we're up to kind of Windows Phone 7 now. We had some fun last time looking at various products, but a lot of HTC and other things. But today, a few different manufacturers coming up. And I was going to start with a product, which was a Samsung device, actually. I don't know whether anyone remembers this. This is the Samsung Focus. Which was a Windows Phone 7 device.
See
the branding on the back there.
Rock solid.
It was rock solid. This was an interesting device. It was marketed on the AT&T network. You can see the AT&T branding there at the top.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes me smile now, but they marketed it as being the only Windows Phone device available in the US which supported an SD card. And I guess for people who had a lot of media, that would have been a very important thing. When this phone was launched, though, one of the things that really stood out was the AMOLED display. It was super bright. Mm. You know, Samsung just have always had these screens that popped. So that was a good thing. I think the other thing, though, was AT&T couldn't help themselves, so they stuffed it full of all of their own software. So there were some of you may remember.
Always a good idea. Phones. Always a
all
good
the
idea.
Don't
start me on that.
All anytime that a telco puts software on a phone, it's a good thing. It's a really good thing.
By the way,
some people might not remember. So you mentioned removable SD cards. So for those that are watching that were born, you know, like in the 2000s, phones used to have not only removable media,
batteries.
But removable batteries too.
Yeah.
So
those were the good old days.
We can demonstrate. So there you go. There is the battery.
What?
We can take that out. And You can see there's the space novelty in there.
SIM card. That was a full size SIM, right?
Wow.
SD card. Right. Yeah, I mean, there's some creative mechanical engineering going on in there with all those little sockets and things.
Absolutely. Ben, what is it going to take to get people to go back to building phones with removable batteries and SD cards? Wouldn't that be lovely?
I think the EU will do that, won't they? Or they're trying to.
I think you'll find that the legislators or regulators are going to try and push in that direction. Sadly, it means that we're going to get thicker phones, but we'll get more.
Yeah, it'll be like a 1-inch thick phone. Fully repaired.
Anyway, there you go. That starts the journey. We can fast forward into 2011, though. And a fun one, really, not least just because of the branding, was this device. And I'll kind of start just by showing this device, and I don't think anybody would have a clue what this product is and who makes it, other than the fact that, you know, the branding at the top very clearly says what platform it relates to. And this is the, as I would say, ZTE, or as my colleagues across the pond would say, ZTE, Tanya, which was the first ever device from a Chinese manufacturer. So they delivered this product. You can see it there, branding front and back. Yeah. It was a very affordable product. It shipped with Windows 7.5 Mango, as people watching this will know that was probably called.
We love Mango. Screen.
And it was cheap. This was an affordable device. So this device, when it came to the UK, was the cheapest Windows phone we'd ever seen. It was £199, about $270. Wow.
Yeah,
it had a pretty poor display. It had a pretty average camera. It only had 4 gigs of storage. But you know what? It was a good bang for your buck in terms of what you were getting.
Yeah, I'm sure they got some marketing development funds from Microsoft for putting all the branding on there.
So. They must have had a ton of money for going that crazy with the branding.
It's probably about as close as Microsoft got to their own phone until the media. Right.
And this was arguably more Microsoft than the Microsoft phones, right? I mean, look.
I think you're right. It's all over it. You're right.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's an interesting kind of brand exercise to say, you know, if Microsoft came to market with phones, should that really be the phone, the cheapest, lowest quality phone, you know? But
you've got to think about the market, and that probably
depending on where you're going with the market. But if you go for business, it's perfect. But that's kind of where the main focus for it was in the business market. Well, sorry, the main sales were. I don't know if that was the focus, but
there was a worldwide market.
How weak the Chinese brands were. So ZTE, you can't even, their brand's not even on this, right? So they were trading on the fact that they felt that. If people don't know who ZTE are, they'll know who Windows are.
And
what Windows is. One. And then to wrap today's little visit to the museum, I'm so excited that we've got to the point where I can put my hand on my heart and say one of the phones that I consider to be the most beautiful of the Windows phone devices arrives. And it's this stunning HTC 8. Which was super thin. It was beautifully designed, and it was a bit of a surprise because HTC at this point was throwing all its energy into Android. And this device arrived, and it was like, wow, it was really amazing. Now, Nokia had announced that they were going to be working exclusively with Microsoft by this point. But this device broke cover, and I remember the gasps when it broke cover at an event, which I remember vividly in San Francisco, in a theater there. It was October 2012, and Steve Ballmer was there on stage talking about this device. But it was a particularly memorable launch because of the fact that Joe Belfiore brought his kids on stage, and they demonstrated a new capability called Children's Zone. Which was something that Microsoft had been working on.
It's a great feature. It was a beautiful device, Ben.
It's gorgeous. It was very tapered at the edges, so it kind of gave the impression of being almost infinitely thin because of the way they designed the mechanical edges.
Yeah, it really contrasted with the bulkier products that Nokia were working on. And this is Scott Croyle, who worked on this. He's a designer who's done some wonderful, wonderful products over the years.
Well done, Scott.
And, yeah.
Does anybody know? Did
that come out as an Android version too? Was there an Android version of that? Or
there wasn't. This remained an ID that was only used, because I was kind of thinking, oh, it'd be nice if they did that on Android. But I think they made the conscious decision to give Microsoft something special. And this was a very special device. It went on to win a Red Dot Product Design Award in 2013. It came in a whole host of different colors as well. I think there were four colors. So obviously black, but also flame red and
I had the flame red one.
Light yellow.
Yeah. Wow. Does anybody notice? You can't help but miss at the bottom of the back there is the Beats logo, Dr. Dre Beats. And so it might be surprising to you know that the Beats folks had a deal going with HTC for a while. They even had branded headphones. And then
didn't HTC buy Beats at some point?
They did.
And then how did they get together and then break apart so that they could later on be acquired by Apple?
That was the genius of Peter Chow, who bought Beats and then made a lot of money by then selling them. So it was a very interesting move. And then obviously Apple got them. But that was the point where, they acquired them or they made at least a 50-50 investment. There was a very, very amusing picture of Dr. Dre and Peter Chow sitting in a recording studio. Do you remember that one, Matt?
Yeah.
It was the big marketing image that they used.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, no, those are some good phones.
That's our visit for today. Some really lovely devices. You know, a device there probably a lot of people haven't seen. But next time round, we'll be diving into the inception of Nokia and the
world of Nokia.
Legendary Lumia 800.
Exactly. Awesome. I wanted to also put the URL here on the screen. So folks, to go to this and look at all the phones that are there and Ben and Matt are also always looking for folks to help fill in the stories behind the phones as well. So I encourage you to go there and support the museum. And, you know, you can spend during your workday, in fact, hours there, which is fantastic. So you're fully authorized by this show to do that.
Well, thank you very much for the support. That's fantastic.
Sounds good. We're going to transfer back now. Okay.
What's really cool is how Ben teleported this beautiful HTC
all the way across
through the internet, literally. It's like the earliest form of a transporter, like Star Trek. Yeah. You turn physical objects into a byte array, send it over the wire, and then we reconstitute it. And there we go. It's a great color. Yeah, he was right. Just razor thin. It's beautiful. You're right. The way it's tapered.
Yeah, super smart design.
Just gorgeous. You were making a comment. You made a comment though about HTC taking one of their popular phones, Android and Windows Phone, and it's this one here.
Oh yeah, that's a big
one. It was called the HTC One, and there was like the M5, the M6, that kind of thing. And it initially came out as an Android device, and then there was a Windows Phone version because guess what? The hardware is exactly the same. Both platforms can use the same stuff. You know, thanks Qualcomm. Anyway, and also what's notable about this device, it's the first time that you could do a bokeh, aka portrait mode photo with any of these devices where you could blur the background. I know.
That's right. Okay. B-O-K-E-H.
Exactly. Because as we all know, over time, things changed. And the most important features of smartphones in the future that we're not at yet became the camera.
That's right.
You know, so who
knows? That was it. And actually, in our next episode, episode 8, which is all about Nokia and Lumia, that's a big focus, right? That was one of the big investments that we had at the time on that.
Absolutely.
All that good stuff. Yeah, no, some cool phones there. I mean, and we talked to Joe about this too. This was the chassis spec era. Yeah. And so you lost a lot of that wonderful innovation.
Right.
That, you know, sometimes wonderful, sometimes not. But, you know, at the time, Windows Phone, if you wanted to build one, there was a chassis spec. And it really said, well, here's the chip and here's the screen and, you know, the navigation and this, that. So it was pretty, like, we went as far as we could to not build a phone, but sort of tell everyone else exactly how to build the phone.
We had so many cool UI effects and the way it works and the panorama, you know, I think you had to have something like a chassis spec just to pull off all the crate design stuff that we were doing. If you had bizarre form vectors, it may not have worked. I don't know.
Well, the alternative would have been, and we're not in an alternative universe, but if we were, you know, Microsoft could have made their own phone according to their chassis spec.
Yeah, true.
They said everyone else, you know, caveat emptor, do whatever you want.
Yeah. Right.
And, you know, and let the market do what they want to do. Might copy exactly what Microsoft was doing. It might not.
Yeah.
Give people the freedom to innovate and then just bet on yourself to win.
Right.
You know, with your own design. That was the chassis spec. But, you know, that would have required a lot more capital and risk. And, in retrospect, I mean, we could all say, sure, they should have taken that risk. But at the time, you know, I think they've been through a lot of bloody noses on hardware businesses with Microsoft.
Good point. You're right.
Tough sell. An ongoing theme. But that was good. So why don't we get into the developer conversation? Maybe before that, let me show a little video for those that thought that, you know, Microsoft didn't care about app developers for phones. I'm going to show a little clip. And one of the interesting historical artifacts is you're going to see a current Microsoft executive from a long time ago. And you probably won't recognize it, but we'll see.
Let's see. Maybe.
We'll bring this in and see what happens.
Let's
see.
Sounds good.
They were able to show publicly some of the kind of the premier apps that third parties are building, running on the phone. We showed him how high quality.
Yeah, he went there for a while.
They really matched the built-in phone experience. These developers have really taken the Windows Phone design system to heart and built quality, beautiful experiences.
Microsoft now is delivering probably one of the best development environments out there in the market, bringing that to a smartphone platform. That ought
IDC,
to be
who are that?
By developers. Yeah. Certainly .NET developers are going to love that.
Twitter.
Wow. Look at that.
I wonder if they'll show a run key. One of their apps.
Today we're making available the final download of the Windows Phone 7 development tools. So specifically Visual Studio 2010 Express for Windows Phone.
And, you see Scott Guthrie today, it always has a red polo on.
Simple setup, easy download.
You know, when this goes live,
forever, not just free.
When this goes live, we'll probably get a cease and desist letter from him because he's not dressed appropriately.
We're Silverlight Shop. We've been doing Silverlight for Vertigo for 3-4 years.
Silverlight,
Our path to be able to build Windows Phone 7 apps allowed us to just focus on the unique aspects of the user experience.
It was actually filmed at the Commons.
The download the tools are available today worldwide, released to manufacturing, released to web. Final release of the Windows Phone developer tools, developer.windowsphone.com. Go get them, be inspired, be awesome, stay nerdy.
Be nerdy,
be inspired. Developer. Yes. I love it.
So, you know, there was an effort.
That is. Absolutely.
There was an effort. But we're going to bring our guests on. We're going to talk about what happened exactly.
I really want to learn myself because I'm still blindsided. I'm hoping to find out what happened.
What are the facts? WTF?
What are the facts? Because I'm currently flummoxed.
How could it go wrong?
We'll find out.
Okay, here we go.
Fantastic. Okay, so we are here with our special guests in our episode 7 here around the developer platform, and here with Rob Tiffany. Rob's at an undisclosed location again.
As always, on the move.
I'm doing a developer meetup at a rest stop right at the border of Oregon and Idaho.
It's Rob and all of his imaginary developer friends are meeting up.
I can see them out there sleeping in the grass. Anyway, it's great.
But we do have some special guests here, so why don't we kind of go through them? We have Peter Torr, we have Andrew Clinick, and Ginny Caughey. And I will let them kind of tell their own sort of origin story about how they came to be part of the greater Microsoft mobile platform story. So maybe we can start at the top box. Peter, why don't you give us your spiel?
Sure. I was actually hired into Microsoft by the gentleman below me, Andrew Clinick, many, many years ago.
It's Andrew's
fault. We worked together. It is all Andrew's fault. We worked together in the developer division for a while doing scripting, moved around quite a bit, ended up in HD-DVD again with Andrew. HD-DVD folded into Kin. Kin folded into something, joined Windows Phone, and was on the Windows Phone platform, which then merged into Windows and was there for, I don't know, 13, 15 years or so. So I just spent a long time working on platforms, Windows and Windows Phone platforms.
Cool.
Awesome. Scripting, like VBScript.
Yeah. JScript, man. Come on.
JScript.
Peter was the JScript guy. I was the VBScript guy.
I you know what? I love JScript in classic active server pages because it had error handling.
That's right.
Which you didn't have with VBScript, so, kind of.
On error, resume next. That's
yeah,
the best.
Come on, man. On resume next. It was beautiful.
You go wrong. I love it.
All right, Andrew, what's the
story? Well, so Peter did a pretty good history of. So I was at Microsoft a little bit longer than Peter. Started as an internet evangelist in Europe, which was fun, telling people how that the internet was going to be big. Did a whole bunch of things, but worked with Pete and both Petes on Kin for a while. I was, you know, we were running that, we're having lots of fun on that. HD-DVD, but then, you know, moved into, you know, had an interesting discussion what I would like to do next, and I was told that I was going to do the Windows developer platform. Like, okay, all right, that's what I'm doing next.
This is what you're doing.
Yeah, and then got to meet all of you again. And, you know, spent, longer than either one of us will ever admit to doing that. All the way through to Windows 10 and Windows 11, doing AI.
All stuff. Right. Yeah. Windows 11.
That's awesome.
Ginny.
Yeah. Well, it really was all Andrew's fault.
I almost spit my coffee out.
That's the title of the episode.
So I guess for the small platforms, I mostly started with Windows Mobile. Mm-hmm. I'm primarily an enterprise developer, and that was a great platform for me. And when I first saw a first look at Windows Phone 7, whatever edition they called it back then, I thought it looked really cool. I love the little dot, dot, dots chasing each other, the animations, and I thought it was just fabulous, and I wanted to just build apps for it. And then I found out I had to forget just about everything I already knew. So what are these angle brackets doing in my code, Andrew? And yet, I will say, to be perfectly honest, all my code now has angle brackets here and there because I've embraced the XAML language for enterprise work in a way that I probably wouldn't have without Windows Phone. But it was an interesting transition from Windows Mobile.
That is. You're going from WinForm kind of like drag and drop to I've got to know this XAML thing.
Just made no sense.
And for our loyal listeners, you'll recognize Ginny from episode 2 because she was also part of our developer discussion around Windows Mobile. So we appreciate her. I think you're our only repeat guest, by the way. So thank
you. I'm honored. Well, I did love Windows Phone. I really did.
As it should be, really. I mean, Ginny was excellent at keeping us all on our toes. And
well, it's good to have that
very
context.
Very politely telling us that perhaps that wasn't the best design that we could have come up with.
but
it would have been a lot worse if it wasn't for Ginny and some of her good friends coming along and telling us what it should be.
Right? That's right. Windows Phone 7 series is going to take over the world with three little dots going across. That's
right.
Game changer. Yep.
Yeah. We had, Joe B on the show. I think the episode before this is Joe B, and he talked about, things around like the panorama and of course like the parallax view and all that cool stuff.
Oh, yeah.
As Joe would talk about. But it was really the architecture, at least the UX experience on Windows Phone was really rethought. And kind of, this is sort of a little bit like Kin too, is like, how do you surface like different services and information within more consistent, like the people card and other things. And that was kind of an interesting framework to think about, especially for like developers. Like we were, I mean, to a certain extent, sort of disaggregating applications into components that then got reassembled in different sort of experiences. That was a little bit different.
Yeah, it was certainly very interesting talking to developers about that. You know, I think Peter and, I don't know if Peter, we, when we were talking with Facebook, that was pretty interesting in terms of you want all of our data in your experience, not ours. As you can imagine, that was a relatively short discussion. with that, but you know, it was really interesting as we were starting to talk to developers, and we talked with folks like Ginny a lot, and that was awesome. That was kind of our bread and butter to a certain extent. But going to talk to the big consumer players, wow, that was quite a shock, I think, for both sides.
Really. Well, there was two challenges. There was that architectural challenge of sort of disaggregating them or commoditizing their data in someone else's UX, which sounds ludicrous today, but back then maybe you could have that conversation. Yeah. And the other issue, of course, was that this was sort of the third ecosystem of two other pretty robust ecosystems at the time with you know, Apple and Android. So it's kind of two challenges there, but yeah, no, and the other thing is that it created a dependency on the API access from these services for this data to flow, which, you know, I remember we had, wasn't there something with like Google and YouTube and they turned off the API access somewhere in the middle? And
they were less keen on us having an app, right?
Yeah. You know, that's a weird thing. We all, in development, chasing APIs, and, you know, as you're taking a dependency on a third party and they keep updating their APIs, and maybe they don't do a good job of how they deprecate or do things in parallel, and it breaks your application. That was a tough thing. And, you know, it's funny. I remember one of our advertisements, we had this notion of glance and go, because no one wants to spend lots of times on their smartphone. They just want to get on with their day and look quickly and see, oh, here's what's going on. I'm out of here. Yeah, we were totally wrong about that.
Yeah, perhaps we should have a doom scroll kind of control. Yes, absolutely.
That would have been great. Hey, Jenny, so what was that? What was that like, that time frame, going from Windows Mobile and the way you were building apps and to making that transition to Windows Phone, completely different with the Silverlight, having to learn about those weird angle brackets. What was that like?
Well, learning the UI, that was brand new territory for me, because I'd never worked with any of those XAML languages at all, or even any web development, which I guess would be more similar. But the business logic was still .NET. So that felt comfortable. So it wasn't a total shock. And expectations were so low at the very beginning, you could have the simplest UI, and if it did something useful, people just loved it. I had one of the first apps in the Windows Phone store back at the time, and ultimately got over 1 million downloads, which is pretty impressive. I know, pretty impressive.
You must be rich.
I charged $1 for the first 1,000 downloads. And then I realized that there was one part of the world that was downloading my app as a demo mode and never converting. And I decided, well, if all of these people get to use it for free, shouldn't everybody, right? So I made it free, and then the downloads started getting, then I got lots more users.
For all million.
But the downside of that is people expected support, and that's awfully hard to do for a free app.
That's a great point. A lot of people, it's like, I'm a developer. I built this cool thing. I'm so thrilled it's in the store. I'm making money, and I'm done, right?
No. Yeah, good luck.
You're on the hook. You're on the hook for support.
Yeah, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean,
people got furious if they lost their data.
What was your app?
No fault of my own.
Do you remember the app? What did you build?
It was Password Padlock. It's still in the Microsoft store. You can still awesome. Download it and I run it on Windows 11. Yeah, you
that's
use it?
Right. That's awesome.
Yeah,
that's
awesome. I'm sorry, but
no support.
No, no, it still works. It's less relevant these days because the browsers can store passwords. Authenticator on my phone now stores a lot of my passwords for me. So it's not as important. But in the time frame, being able to share passwords between big windows and little windows in your hand that's actually a phone, that's pretty useful.
Yeah. It was unique pretty much at the time.
Oh, I think it was, yeah. I had some deep conversations with the OneDrive team as they kept switching their APIs on me and breaking my stuff because that was where the data got stored.
Was that SkyDrive?
It was initially, yep. That was one of the changes, SkyDrive to OneDrive. You're absolutely right. Yeah.
But I think it's an interesting point because security for apps and in general was a whole new thing for Windows that we really introduced in Windows Phone. And it was a source of, well, mostly we'd send them to Peter to really but it was that was a huge, huge challenge, right, Peter? People just didn't get that then.
Yeah, I mean, there was the sandbox nature of it all, so you didn't have access to all the resources that you thought you did. You had to remediate through things like a photo picker or a file picker, et cetera. And the APIs weren't particularly good for that. The other big challenge kind of architecturally, obviously all the APIs change, but we deal with API changes, language changes fairly often. But the big architectural change in Windows Phone in the early days was the whole tombstoning model. Right. So the app is running, the user hits the start button or the search button or whatever. And your app is told, hey, you've got like 5 seconds to save all of your state, and then we're going to terminate your process. And no one's ever done this before, right? Like we've had virtual memory for a long, long time. Operating systems just page stuff out and page it back in off disk. And so the ability for apps, especially existing apps with large code bases, to suddenly come along and say, wow, I've got 5 seconds to save everything I know about the user's current task was essentially impossible. And so we had apps like Angry Birds is an example. Angry Birds, great game. You know, it was on the other platforms. We had it on Windows Phone. But they, for whatever reason, couldn't save their state within the 5 second time frame. And so they kind of cheated and used one of our other APIs to keep the phone on. So even if you, hit the power button on your phone, they kept running in the background. I think they claimed they were doing music playback or GPS or something like that, but there were certain rules where you could keep running.
All right.
And so Angry Birds would keep working, but your battery would die super, super quick. Like, yeah, I can play Angry Birds for 10 minutes. and then moving forward, since we're also talking about Windows, the other huge architectural change as Windows Phone merged into Windows and Windows platform was the asynchronous nature of virtually all of the APIs.
Yeah.
That was such a substantial change to the way people build applications. Again, it's not just changing API from calling foo to calling bar, but it's rethinking. I can't block while this file opens. I can't block while this socket connects. I have all these tasks and threads running. And it was just something that was too hard for people to do. Or if they did it, it introduced all sorts of other bugs and problems. And I think that's one of the big reasons why the platform wasn't as successful as we thought it might be, was just you can change languages, you can change frameworks, but you really can't change the way you think about how the app is built overnight.
That's a good point. You know, it's funny when you talk about tombstoning. I totally forgot about that. Yeah, I did. Didn't that have a lot to do with the first version of Windows Phone, Windows Phone 7? You know, it was like, all right, we're going to baby step our way into this new thing. We're only going to have, you know, I remember the term e-figs. These are the only language you support. I remember we're just going to have one app running at a time because we don't want to get crazy because we don't really know what we're doing quite yet. We're getting there. And so that led, because prior to that, and also like with Android, everything could run at the same time. It was just like Windows, you know. Windows Mobile was just like Windows. Everything's running simultaneously. And then to your point, Peter, there was no sandbox. There was no secure containerization in old Windows Mobile. You could see everything and grab and do whatever you wanted. It was kind of a free-for-all. And I'm sure people were accustomed to that. And then all of a sudden, it's like, oh, I'm in this little box here. Well, we're doing it for your own good. We don't want you to do anything stupid. Yeah.
And it ended up being really jarring because people would switch between apps way more than they thought they would. Yeah. And it would take forever to get back to the, because you would reload the app.
Yeah.
And right.
Doesn't matter how good your code is. And, you know, that really kind of started to show some of the challenges of being just .NET, which is awesome. .NET's a great way to go do it. But a lot of the apps that were really driving experiences on the other phone, iOS and Android, they were utilizing C and Assembler just to eke out every piece of performance as they could. Yeah. And we had this crazy scheme where if you wanted to use C++, Assembler, forget it. That wasn't even... You had to send an email, which basically went to me. And then you had to convince me that it was the right thing to go do. And I wasn't really allowed to say yes. So it was this weird situation. And I think it was WhatsApp that was finally the ones who basically called us on our, I'll be G-rated, on our poor decision-making. And forced us to change. Because they're like, we're not going to rewrite WhatsApp's core engine just for your phone. It's just like, no, we're not going to do that.
Actually, I think it might have been Spotify, actually.
Oh, yeah, Spotify, yeah. Yeah, because Spotify has their own crazy kind of encoding and encryption scheme.
Their own DRM, their own codec and everything. And that was one of their competitive advantages, was like they could start streams instantly. And they're probably the ones that broke down the wall a little bit on native code on Windows Phone.
Yeah. Well, I remember that, guys. The networking stack on the Windows Phone .NET was not the best. And they actually sent us an Internet for Dummies book. So
nice.
A tough debugging session with them.
Oh my god, that's so funny.
Yeah.
So I'm imagining it's like right out of Oliver. Please, sir, may I use C++? Oh my gosh. That's pretty crazy.
And one of the funny things about that is that Windows and Windows Phone were going kind of in parallel at this point. We hadn't really merged.
Yeah.
And Windows Phone was actually more permissive in terms of native code than Windows was at the time. Windows wouldn't let you use sockets, for example. You couldn't call, WinSock on Windows Phone. You couldn't create a thread. Sorry, on Windows platform, you couldn't create a thread, an explicit thread in Windows. Like, sockets and threads are two of the most important things for things like games, right? Multiplayer games.
Yeah.
And so we allowed them onto Windows Phone because we wanted the games. All the mobile devices had games. Windows still had desktop apps, so they could just go back into desktop stuff. But Windows Phone actually drove a lot of the native platform back into big Windows, because we were trying to align, which is kind of crazy to me.
Yeah, we learned the hard way.
Well, and also Windows Phone had the store for apps first before before Windows did, right? I mean, there is kind of a backward thing going on there too. I think we had talked about that with John Traynor about Windows Mobile. One of the big things that was missing out of Windows Mobile was an app store, which you would think these days, for young kids that are listening, there used to be phones without app stores on them. And so Windows Mobile, that was a big cornerstone of, I think we actually got it in 6.5, didn't we? Wasn't there a store there?
We did create a little mini me app store, and because 6.5 was going to be this bridge holdover. What a lot of people don't realize is we kept trying to build Windows Mobile 7.
Right.
And you can find pictures and videos if you ever see. I uploaded the Girl from Mars video to our LinkedIn group. That will actually show you what we were actually going to launch, and then we didn't. It goes back to the discussions around app compat. Are we going to have this evolution from Windows Mobile to something new?
Right.
Or some sudden jarring change, which, in the end, we did the latter.
We had the sudden.
But there were many attempts, though, to just keep doing, Windows Mobile 7 and give it a better UI and things like that. And
well, that's a good question, Rob. I mean, like, I don't know, Ginny, maybe from your perspective, since you were in the MVP community, it's like, it was, the Windows Phone platform was beautiful with the three dots and all that stuff and the parallax panorama. But from a developer, like, we had built up a pretty good head of steam with developers in Windows Mobile and Windows CE for probably about 10 years. And so what was that like that hard cut, basically?
Well, it was a major ouch for sure. But the hardest thing, and it's still to some degree a problem with WinUI, which is a modern framework, UI framework for Windows, that not all of the capability that I needed for enterprise was available in Silverlight or then later in UWP. And so I ended up not building enterprise apps for Windows Phone. That and the store model just sort of made that a no-go. Consumer apps, perfect, was great. The store made it workable, easy, really. Mm-hmm. Signing was easy, but for enterprise, it was tricky. Of course, there were enterprise apps on Windows Phone. One of my favorite ones back in the day was a Delta app. And it just pleased me no end if I'd be sitting in the Atlanta airport and a flight had been changed, I would get that notification quicker on my Windows Phone than all the other people in the lounge were or in the area were. And I could get to the desk and reschedule my flight quicker. So
the Delta app
was just there's
a story behind the Delta app. I mean, inside Microsoft, you've got all these teams. You've got this group called, back then it was called EPG, where all the sales folks were. And there was compete teams. And I remember getting to be involved in that. There was a whole lot of work behind the scenes to get Delta to adopt Windows Phone on the Nokia devices and our programming model, because it wasn't easy.
No.
But there was a lot of high level executive. We really need that Delta app. And the flight attendants, remember they had the Delta.
Yeah, they used them in the aisles for transactions.
Yeah, absolutely. They did. They had red ones.
A lot of work and a lot of maybe almost CEO to CEO level stuff happened to get Delta to do that. And it's like, thanks, Delta. I don't know how long that lasted before we were gone, but you know.
Well, it was definitely a win-win in that time frame.
That was a big one. Someone got a trip to Hawaii on that one.
Somebody got a trip to Hawaii.
Well, they were ahead of their time, really. They replaced all their kind of printed documents with, I think they put surfaces in the...
They did,
in the content, right? And they went fully digital before anybody else did.
Yeah, they were forward thinking, no doubt about it.
Yeah, unfortunately, it didn't work with Starbucks, but you know.
Ginny, you alluded. I heard you talk about Silverlight, something called UWP.
I know.
I remember prior to that, there was something that looked like WinForms. Are you telling me there were multiple ways to build apps at different generations of Windows Phone?
In the Windows CE days, I was using Visual C++. So I was using basically MFC because I needed the performance too. In that time frame, the hardware was kind of pokey. But
I remember embedded VB and embedded C++ at the very beginning, like the Pocket PC days.
You're very lucky, Rob. That was VB script.
It was VB script.
Yes.
I loved it. Love you. Yes. Love you guys. Yeah. Thanks for the script. Love you. Yeah. Love it. And it looked kind of like Visual Studio, kind of, and it was kind of drag and drop, but it was VB script behind the scenes.
It was free too.
And it was free. Right. And then
I wrote an article for, was it Mind Magazine? Was that what it was back then?
Probably was.
Microsoft Interactive Developer. Is that script in your pocket? I think was actually.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
You're famous. Yes, that was awesome. And so we
different
went from
days.
That. Yeah. So we had embedded VB, and then we built the .NET Compact framework, and everybody was thrilled about that. And
right.
We had a giant community, which you were a driving force behind, Ginny. And then people working out problems like marshalling and weird. Remember, you had the OpenNet CF group that came along to.
Oh yeah, it's P-Invoke City there.
P-Invoke City. So to fill in all the gaps that the Compact framework couldn't do. And then
starting with
sudden,
serial ports of all things.
Well, but remember, Zebra, Intermec, Motorola.
Oh, yeah
Windows vertical markets.
Early success was in rugged devices, barcode scanning, that kind of thing. And so, and then you're right. Then Windows Phone comes along, and it's Silverlight. Don't listen to what Bob Muglia just said. We're going to go with Silverlight.
And for your barcode, you have to be able to take a picture of it and figure out what's in the picture.
Right.
Give me an opportunity to shine.
That's what it was. I'm glad to know.
Ginny, what was UWP? What is that?
Well, I think the U was universal and P was platform. W?
All right. Was this an attempt to do Windows 8 and Windows Phone apps at the same time?
Well, not only that, but it ran on HoloLens too. So it was pretty universal. I mean, still is. It's just
Xbox as well. It was
Xbox, yep. Yeah. So that's a lot of different platforms, different hardware platforms, different chipsets, different capabilities. Yeah. It was really, and it had some nice library that was just part of it, some really good controls, and the control vendors embraced it.
Right. That's good.
But the main problem was that to improve it, it was tied to the operating system, right, Peter and Andrew? So you had to have an operating system change to get a new version of your UI framework that you were using. Kind of the same issue that you get with .NET and .NET Core. So freeing the code that you needed from the operating system, that was a big win, but it was a painful situation for developers and probably a much more painful situation for Microsoft too, because I expect it was quite a lot of work.
And well, coordinating amongst all the different releases, that was, because it started out real easy. It was like, you know, Windows and Windows Phone were kind of on the same schedule, mostly.
Mostly.
And Xbox, well, yeah, they did it once, but then that lasted for 3 months, maybe, Peter, and then it just exploded. It's just like, oh my goodness. And, you know, it was really, it was an interesting project to work on in terms of what do you try and deliver? But, you know, as soon as phone went away, that fateful day, then it's like, well, who wants, the amount of people who want to write an Xbox, a HoloLens, and a Windows app, there are a few, and, they're the larger kind of consumer companies that you might think about, but probably, if there's more than 50 people, I'd be shocked. Right? Right. They actually want to do that. Right? They actually want to write something that's really good for each one of those things.
The other thing is that people, specifically in the Xbox world, so if you're in this world where you want a Windows thing and an Xbox thing, then you're probably also on PlayStation, Roku, every internet-connected TV ever. And so you can't pick Windows as your platform. You pick the web. You pick something like a Chromium-based thing. And so even for people that wanted cross-platform, UWP wasn't really great because they didn't want the W. They wanted everything.
Right.
Everything.
They had very different...
Universal.
Yeah, they just wanted UP, which is the web.
Right.
Can we get UP, please?
Yeah.
That was interesting. Yeah. And, there was always the specter. Well, specter is not the right word. There's this thing that never went away, and it's called Win32. And that's because in the 1990s, tens of millions of Win32 apps were built for Windows. And that was kind of the real rise of Microsoft.
Yeah.
And then we started doing these managed higher level languages, stuff like that. But those Win32 guys wouldn't go away. And we gyrated, bent over backwards. Remember all these different, was it Centennial? All kinds of projects to try to get your Win32 app to still be a first class citizen. Because when you talk to all the giant corporations, they were just like, yeah, that's great. I'm glad you're building all this stuff, but we're running on the stuff we built in
thousands.
DB and Delphi and Power Builder and all those tools back in the 90s.
Thousands of apps.
Yeah. Well,
Centennial allowed you to put those apps in the store too. And that was really big for certain kinds of apps that would have never been in the store at all.
Something like iTunes, right?
Yeah, iTunes, Evernote, a whole bunch of Office was even in the store there for a while.
Yep, that's right.
And it was interesting because what it really kind of showed up was the reason why people weren't in the store was not really a technology issue. I mean, there was always the occasional technology issue. It really came down to business model. Mm-hmm. And it's like, we have a pretty successful business model on Windows because we're still here. And you want... what percent of that to be in your store? And it was very interesting for folks who had free apps.
Yes.
Because it's like, you'll take all my distribution costs. Sure, sweet, I'll do that. But if you want to make money, which most people do, right?
So
it really brought that into kind of focus in terms
of... That's a good point. Because obviously today we've seen lawsuits, around Apple and everything, Epic and the EU's really forced Apple's hand on the iPhone. And you're right. All these people are like, why am I giving up 30%? Now, Apple, and Android would make the case, well, we started it that way. But the problem with the Windows, the Microsoft ecosystem, is they had decades of, no, that's not how it works.
That's right.
this is how it works. And so, yeah, it's kind of jarring.
Yeah, yeah. Distributing apps on Windows is something that people had worked out how to do pretty effectively. Mm-hmm. Exactly. You can't really put a lid on Pandora's box and try
to
go to something else.
People are installing floppy since the caveman times. And so they know how it works. And then we upgraded the CDs. Times,
yes,
the CD-ROM, you know, so we could install Encarta or something. Yeah.
That's right. The other thing I think maybe we can talk about a little bit with Windows Phone, which was an innovation that made it to Windows and then I think has now died. I'm not sure, but it was Live Tiles. Live Tiles and the origin of Live Tiles. I think in Kin, actually, pre-Windows Phone, right, we had a screen that was dynamic.
The magazine of your life, Peter.
The magazine of your life, yes. We'll have that in another episode. But the... But then the in Windows Phone, right? That was a big thing. Was like this tile would pop up a little bit of info about your app, and it called Live Tiles, and that was kind of a new innovation that I think consumers liked it a lot.
Loved it.
If I had a dollar for every time I saw Andrew do a presentation at a conference on Live Tiles, I would be richer than Ginny with her app that she had in the store.
Yeah, it resonated with users, but also resonated with developers because it was pretty simple to do. I think that was the key thing. It was like, it didn't do everything. And yeah, the people would ask us for lots of different things, but it was like, okay, we used to kind of joke it was the, you know, the Friday afternoon feature. It was like, you wanted to impress your boss, you could get it done in a couple of hours, really, and make it better and all those things.
Yeah.
And glitzier too. I mean, it really looked really nice. Attract
people's attention.
Yeah, right?
It was like, oh, you could just lift up your phone and it would, and they got pretty good attach rates and kind of engagement mm-hmm. from it. And we got a lot of grief when we went to Windows.
Hmm.
Yeah,
because it went to Windows, but the engagement just wasn't there. And and I think the key thing is. I don't know about you, but you know, on the phone, the start menu was always there. You would pull it out of your pocket and it was right there.
There it is. Yep.
Start menu on Windows. Well, let's forget about Windows 8, right? We're on Windows 10 at this point, right? Okay. Because Windows 8, they either completely Windows 8 essentially taught them to ignore it. It was like, okay, like I don't like that thing, so I'll just press Windows and start searching for things. Or and then you know, so it didn't resonate in 8. And then on 10, once it's on the start menu, you only see it a little bit. So you don't get that level of engagement. Yeah,
that's true. It is. Yeah. It's a different engagement model for sure. Yeah. Now I think they've deprecated it, right? I don't think there is even.
Right. It doesn't show up anymore, but you know, we have widgets.
We do have widgets and they can be lively, more lively than you might even want sometimes.
Yeah.
but you can turn those off too. So.
Yeah. It's finding the engagement model is really, and, you know, I think Windows is still trying to work out what that engagement surface is.
And also whether or not to be have an ad model for revenue that's tricky because that's new for Windows as well. It'll be interesting to see how that plays out going forward.
Hmm.
You know, a common conversation around developers on Windows in the big sense, glacial over time, and you know, and both of you guys were doing stuff with scripting in the web, was as soon as the web got really big and interactive and stuff like that, we saw a dramatic decline of native apps being built for big Windows.
Yep.
It actually fell off a cliff. And so you got to the point, the only native app on Windows that you cared about was Office, maybe your browser, some cool complex app like Adobe or something like that. But especially in the enterprise, you know, the rise of active server pages and JSP and all the web just took over. It was easier to, you didn't have to worry about deployment issues and all that kind of stuff. I would say the rise of smartphones saved native app development temporarily. Because everything was going web and then all of a sudden you had smartphones and you had to go native. And it's like, oh, thank God I can use my old skills again and build native apps for this thing, even though the web's killed everything else. And obviously, so we got to do that WinForms kind of thing and Silverlight, you know, Android embraced Java, you know, and obviously iOS was, you know, doing stuff going all the way back to Next, right? With their platform. And it kept it native, and the web wasn't very good on the phone until the iPhone came out, you know, basically. And so there's just interesting dynamics when you think about going from a WinForms thing to a Silverlight to a UWP. And on the one hand, you're looking, hey, we're doing innovations, and this is great stuff. And then on the other hand, there's developers on another track on another platform. It's like, no, we just kept using Java the whole time, and maybe it wasn't as exciting, but it didn't change. You know what I mean? It stayed the same. And so the notion of radical change to developers, even if it was supposed to be better, you know, they may have had a different perspective. You never know.
Well, they're still chasing the latest framework too in the web world. So I don't know that that's a solved problem for them either.
No doubt. JavaScript frameworks is la la land. Yeah.
Yeah.
You're right. You're always chasing that. No doubt about it.
But we certainly did add a whole level of change that just impacted everything. And you're right, Rob, and Ginny, in terms of the changes that developers saw. But, you know, we went through three operating systems in Windows Phone.
Yep.
Yeah.
And the amount of time that took away from the developer platform.
Mm-hmm.
So that you could, because you were, well, shoot, we got to get it working on, you know, Windows 8 now and Windows. It kind of bled any innovation out of the developer platform. So there was kind of a double whammy. We were changing things, but with less people and hence doing it less well, to be fair.
And I think it's actually maybe even a triple whammy, if you'll allow me that. Because back in the olden days, you pretty much owned all of your source code, right? You owned your entire product. You might license a particular proprietary library from somebody, but you owned all the code. You wrote all the code. Fast forward to, you know, 10 plus years ago going forwards. No, your app is 90% library somebody else wrote with a dependency chain you don't understand. Yep. And the 10% you put on top. And none of those libraries, not a single library ever written, would work on Windows or Windows Phone in the modern platform. Couldn't open a file, couldn't create a thread, couldn't do this. Mm-hmm. Nothing worked. And so even if you personally wanted to bring your app to the platform, and even if you personally loved Silverlight, you loved XAML or whatever, and you wanted to put your code on the platform, if that library you wanted or one of its 10,000 dependencies hadn't been rewritten for a marginal platform, you were dead in the water. And so there's the things like there's the massive changes, there's all this, that, but the dependency on third-party code didn't exist 30 years ago, and it does today. Everybody depends on third-party code, and those third parties didn't move because there was no reason to move.
And at that's the time, if it did work on Windows, it only ran on Win32, those libraries.
Yes,
right.
So they're like, oh, it works on Windows. Why do we need to do anything else, right?
So. Right. And so to me, the third-party library problem was probably the single biggest thing that stopped UWP from taking off. Because you can make arguments for people to bring their own platform, their own apps, but if their dependencies didn't come along, there's nothing they could do.
Right.
Good point.
Yeah, literally. Yeah, no, that's critical. So I think it's an interesting time in history. And I think it's as we talked about, there's so many different platforms and interdependencies, especially a company like Microsoft that had so many different platforms. It's kind of ironic. I mean, Microsoft sort of built its, you know, business on developers and that whole Win32 developer ecosystem for decades. I think coming into the 2000s and the 2010s, things started to get a little weird. And like you said, Rob, with the rise of the web and a richer web experience and things like that, and then pressure from you know, Apple and Google on their ecosystems, it was a tough slog to sort of get developers to embrace all these new innovations that we were trying to do on the platform. So it's a tough one. Plus, you know, the unit volumes were, you know, that's a whole other discussion. Not super high. So
Microsoft is not used to not succeeding. Being second is kind of Microsoft's game, but like not making progress was.
It was tough. Frustrating. Frustrating. Yeah.
That's a good point because you brought it up, Andrew. You know, as we're changing these operating systems, like what's left for the developer platform, or how much money, how many resources do these guys get to do their thing? Because you're right, we had this CE-based thing for so many years, all the way through Mango, and then that upheaval going to the NT kernel on Windows Phone 8 was a huge, huge effort. Wow.
Yeah, it was fun times though. It was, you know,
we built
some pretty cool products, and you know, a lot of the innovations that kind of came out of that percolated into, you know, even into Azure, into the cloud stuff, and thinking about the things that we go do.
Yeah, and that's a good point.
It's kind of nice in a weird way to see other people kind of copying it now.
And yeah, you look
at an Android phone, iOS, it's like, well, you know, you can tell where some of that came from.
Live Tile.
You can. Yeah.
They went to your talks, Andrew, on Live Tiles. They're like, I remember Mr. Clinick told me about Live Tiles.
That is obviously the reason they went that way, I think. Yeah.
Exactly.
That's right.
Long you know, lesson. I'm sure Johnny Ives was sitting there going, you know, I think Andrew Clinick talked about
it's
this.
It's a British man.
Yeah.
You guys got to stick together. I told you.
Yeah, he and I are like this.
Yeah. I know a highlight for me at that last time, though, is I spent like 24 or 48 hours doing videos with Andy Wiggly, and we did Windows Phone 8 developer jumpstart thing. And that was, you know, we were dying in there recording just all day for 2 days doing that stuff. But it was a lot of fun. A lot of people watched it. It's like, here's how to do this.
We locked in a darkened room for like 3 weeks or something.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, it was crazy stuff. No doubt about it. Good times. We had this enthusiastic developer community, you know, and we've talked about before. In the end, we made lots of friends. We had lots of great experiences with a lot of good people who really cared a lot about this platform. That was a lot of fun.
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah. It was certainly was a lot of fun.
That was a good.
Still is, right, Ginny?
Oh well, yeah.
Bill's coming up. I'm expecting great things.
Well, Bill always delivers something. Always. Okay. Used to deliver actually phones. I think somewhere around here. I have a phone I picked up at Bill 1 year.
Oh, look at that. Yeah. Oh,
those were the days.
Nice.
I remember that. Yeah. We used to hand
you remember that one? Yeah. So we got phones so we could try it out. Hmm. That was a great strategy. We handed out,
were they early? No, they weren't Surfaces. They were Samsungs, I think. The PC. Samsungs. Remember the first tablets?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That's all kinds of crazy things.
Well, I appreciate everyone's time. We've covered a lot of ground here. It's fantastic. And Peter, Andrew, and Ginny, once again, Ginny, thank you. And Rob, I think we're, you know, it's an interesting chapter. I'm sure there's lots more to talk about, but I really appreciate everyone kind of sharing their memories and insights on this one.
It was fun.
Good stuff.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah.
All right. It's good to see you
all. All right, everybody. Take care.
Thanks.
Bye, y'all.
Bye-bye.
Sorry.
Was I interrupting?
And we're back. Wow.
Your call from 2009.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Just a lot of changes when you think about it. Just that whole conversation. Three operating systems.
Yeah.
Development platforms.
Sure. I mean, it was almost like a, I don't want to say perfect storm, but even without the internal sort of self-inflicted wounds from Microsoft, sort of battling each other, you know, big windows versus little windows and all that.
Right.
Just the, I think you had mentioned it too, like the increase in functionality in the web, you know, where people are spending more and more time, and the Android and Apple platforms, even if Microsoft executed 100%, you know, it would have been really tough to kind of gain share there and really be a viable ecosystem. And Peter made that point about all the dependencies and all the libraries. You'd have to get the whole ecosystem dependencies to move over.
That was a great point that he made about that.
Yeah. Even if the Instagram folks are like, yeah, I'll do Instagram. And then all of a sudden the whole thing breaks because the libraries were over.
And so
so it was like, and then of course, Microsoft, you know, at the time, and they didn't really dig into this too much, but the whole big Windows, little Windows, Windows mobile, Windows phone versus big Windows, you know, unfortunately, we won't get to have Steven Sinofsky here to debate Terry Myerson to talk about that, but that would be quite an episode.
I would love to see that, actually. That'd be fun.
Maybe the director's cut will get that.
Maybe so.
Everyone, you know, you remember when they, when was it Windows 8? They came out with a store, you know, an app store.
Right.
Belatedly after Windows Phone did. And then it was two different app stores. Like, you submitted two different times and the payouts were different. I kept thinking to myself, can't you just coordinate on that? I mean, this kind of one pipeline, one payout.
But no. You know, there's so many things that if we could go back in time, Mr. Thanos, that I feel like we had a problem with liking to change things too much for the sake of changing things. Because just as you brought that up about the store on Windows 8, you know, I had a couple of friends who were on that development team. And to build the first store on Windows 8, it was some combination of JavaScript and COM. Remember COM and DCOM and COM Plus and all that stuff, Common Object Model? You know, what we called, remember we used to call it Olay? In the early 90s and mid 90s, object linking embedding. Anyway, COM objects, the whole operating system is based on COM. Somebody built some kind of thing where you could have JavaScript talk to COM objects, and the first store was written in that. Needless to say, they rewrote it later. But it goes to the systemic thing. It's just kind of seeping into me, just these conversations, was this needless changing of how the OS worked, how the platform worked, how the developer
we architected it differently, you know. And, you know, meanwhile, Apple has the iTunes, you know, app, which is, I mean, I'm not speaking out of turn here. Everyone thinks it's garbage, and it has been garbage forever, but it just worked.
It just works. It's Win32. And yeah.
Still works and worked well. So
yeah.
Sometimes, you know, the most beautiful and elegant architecture is on the latest technology is not necessarily the way to go.
This is what happens if you let the developers take over.
There you go.
And not because I'm a developer, but I saw the light over time, you know, and because they love to just try new things and listen. Oh, sure, I don't know what I was thinking last year. We should re-architect Windows to work this way. Duh. You know, let's do it. Yeah.
Hey, let's end on a high note.
Oh, thank God for that.
I wanted to, we cannot do a 9-part series on the rise and fall of Microsoft mobile platform without mentioning Smoked by Windows Phone.
You got to get smoked.
Arguably one of the best campaigns out there, because it really landed the fact that this UI was different. Now, obviously, we know the outcomes, but when this came out around the Mango timeframe, and I can remember the marketing team kind of switched from green to red. Remember that?
Yeah, like, I do. Yes, you know, you're right.
Little red tiles and red.
Yeah, yeah.
Interesting. I don't know. But Smoke by Windows Phone, and let me just kind of play the video, and then we can. Here we go. Let's see.
Awesome.
Let's see what we got here. So good. And, you know, in another parallel universe, we would have had Ben Rudolph on here to explain, but maybe in the director's cut.
Yeah, he'll probably be in the director's cut.
Yeah, sure, why not?
The director cut is like 30 hours long, though, I think.
Oh, yeah, it's huge.
Yeah. It's right, totally.
Let's see what we got.
Hey, I'm Ben. And today we're betting people $100 that Windows Phone is simply faster at the everyday stuff they do on their smartphones.
What kind of phone do you have?
I have the HTC Evo 3D.
I have a Motorola Atrox, actually.
Motorola Atrox. That's a pretty good phone. You've got a Samsung Galaxy S2.
Nick has a Galaxy Nexus, correct?
Flagship phone of Google.
The flagship phone of Google. Android phone, pretty good phone.
Yeah.
You like it?
Oh, I love it. It's the best.
Okay. The best? The best. Strong words from our friend Justin. Why don't we do this? Why don't we try taking a picture and then posting it up to Facebook?
So why don't we look for someplace nearby, find like a 4-star restaurant.
Okay.
And then we'll pull up directions there. Ready? 1, 2, 3, go, go, go. Boom. Uploading to Facebook.
Boom.
Boom. Done. Posting to Facebook. I got you by a little bit. Done.
Wow, I just haven't even put Twitter up yet.
All right, so I got Claim Jumper. It's a 4-star restaurant, and I've already got directions pulling up.
I just heard that Claim Jumper is a 4-star restaurant.
What? So let me show you why this works. Tap this button here. It's called Local Scout. It shows me nearby places to eat and drink. I can just find whatever I want, whether by rating, by type. I tap Starbucks. It gives me everything that I need to know about Starbucks. All I have to do to take a picture on my Windows phone is I just have to hold down the button, take a picture, and then I've got one-touch sharing of the Facebook. This is called my Me Time. It tells me everything about me and connects me instantly to all my social networks.
My Motorola Droid X got smoked by a Windows phone.
I got smoked by a Windows phone.
There you go.
Wow.
Now that is some good marketing.
Right, that's there. Great marketing.
Yeah.
You know, it would have been really fun if, like, I was thinking, you know, because we're really old, the whole Folgers coffee deal, we secretly replaced the coffee at this high-end restaurant with Folgers crystals. If they'd done it in an Apple store, and we just embedded some Windows phones amongst the iPhones. What is this? How do I get this? Fantastic. Get somebody from the Genius Bar right away. I'm getting smoked.
Right.
Yeah. Good stuff.
I think I'm going to go head off to the Claim Jumper and get some dinner.
Yeah. So, I remember the Claim. Is it still there in Redmond? Yeah, I think it is, actually. By Redmond Town Center, maybe. I don't know. That's pretty funny. 4-star restaurant.
Our restaurant.
It's awesome. That is awesome.
All right. Well, I think we'll wrap it up here, episode 7, and we'll see everyone on the other side for episode 8, which is going to be the working title is Let's Sauna. It's all about Nokia and Lumia, and we have Tuula Ritola as a special guest on that episode. We're going to dig into the whole Finland-Redmond alliance.
Finland and Redmond go together like peanut butter and chocolate, don't they?
Sure. I guess we'll find out.
We'll find out.
All right.
Adios.
Talk to you later.